الله أكبر الله أكبر الله أكبر أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله أشهد أن لا أشهد أن محمد رسول الله أشهد أن محمد رسول الله حي على السلام حي على السلام حي على الفلاح الرحمن الرحيم
صراط الذين أنعمت عليهم غير المغضوب عليهم ولا الضالين. قل يا عبادي الذين أسرفوا على أنفسهم لا تقنطوا من رحمة الله، إن الله يغفر الذنوب جميعا إنه هو الغفور الرحيم. وأنيبوا إلى ربكم وأسلموا له من قبل أن يأتيكم العذاب ثم لا تنصرون.
The translation of these verses is: Say, O my servants who have sinned against their souls, despair not of the mercy of Allah. Surely Allah forgives all sins. Verily, He is most forgiving, ever merciful. And turn to your Lord and submit yourselves to Him before there comes unto you the punishment, for then you shall not be helped. In various verses of the Holy Quran, with reference to different subject matters, Allah the Almighty gives the hope to His servants that He is the most forgiving and ever merciful. In the first verse of the Holy Quran that I have just recited, it is precisely this topic that is being outlined. Therein is a beautiful message for every such person who is fearful of the wrath of Allah due to his sins, a message of attracting the blessings of Allah the Almighty and of acquiring beneficence from His mercy and from His forgiveness. Allah says that, O my servants, do not despair of my mercy, for I am the master and I possess all powers to forgive you of your sins and to wrap you in my cloak of mercy. So what a beautiful message this is, which increases our hope and expectations and eliminates all despair and hopelessness. It is this very message that informs people that frustration and despair are sin. This very message also helps us to remove our weaknesses and to avoid failures in our life. For often, it is frustration and despair which are the root cause of sin and failure in life. But one who comes under the mercy of God the Almighty is never touched by hopelessness or failure. It is this very message that illuminates to us the path of treading upon the commandments of Allah the Almighty and of loving God. Thus we can be enabled to continuously seek nearness to God the Supreme and to constantly ascertain beneficence from His blessings and bounties. So thus this message is a lit up path for every person who is astray. This is a life-giving message for all who are spiritually dead. This message is a glad tiding of deliverance and salvation for all those who are trapped in the clutches of Satan. How beautiful our God is, who cast His loving eye of mercy in this manner. God repeatedly says to those who believe in Him, وَلَا تَأْيَسُوا مِنْ رُوحِ
اللَّهِ
and despair not of the mercy of Allah. Because لَا يَعْسُوا مِنْ رُوحِ اللَّهِ إِلَّا الْقَوْمُ الْكَافِرُونَ that for none despairs of Allah's mercy save the disbelieving people.
بس اگر ایمان کا دعویٰ ہے تو اللہ تعالیٰ کی رحمت اور بخشش کی
So thus, if you claim to have faith, then always be in hope of the mercy and forgiveness of God. Due to your human weaknesses, you have fallen to some vices, but you are not amongst those who have gone astray and who are lost. Only those despair of the mercy of Allah who are astray, who do not believe in the existence of God nor in His mercy. Falling to despair is the way of those who are astray, as Allah the Almighty says. وَمَنْ يَقْنَتُ مِنْ رَحْمَةِ رَبِّهِ إِلَّا
الظَّالُونَ
And who despairs of the mercy of his Lord, but such as go astray. Thus certainly those who are perturbed, those who are worried, and those who due to their state, for those who are restless, there can be no greater message for sympathy, compassion, and contentment and tranquility of the heart. Further, Allah the Almighty, for our contentment, also says to us that He will not be quick in wrath for your bad deeds. In fact, بَرَّبُّكُ الْغُفُورُ ذُو الرَّحْمَةُ That your Lord is most forgiving and ever merciful. Because كَتَبَ رَبُّكُمْ عَلَى نَفْسِهِ الرَّحْمَةُ That He has made it essential upon Himself to extend to you mercy. So therefore, He forgives the sins that you commit out of ignorance. So give heed towards your reformation. If you strive to reform and look towards His mercy, then He is Ghafoor Rahim. He is the most forgiving and ever merciful. Furthermore, it is not only that He is most forgiving and ever merciful. In fact, Allah the Almighty says, وَرَحْمَتِي وَسِعَتْ كُلَّ شَيْءٍ That My mercy encompasses all things. Here the matter goes beyond even the Mu'mins, the believers. It is not only the believers who are being spoken of here. The mercy of God also extends to the disbelievers. And for the believers it is essential. God can forgive all sins and He does so, is what He says. He is the Malik, the Master. He is not bound by any restrictions or conditions for forgiveness. However, does it not require of such a loving and merciful God who extends His forgiveness and mercy that we act in the way that He wishes us to, that we tread upon His commandments and increase our love for Him, that we draw nearer to Him, and that we try our level best to eliminate our weaknesses, shortcomings, sins and vices. Now all of these things that I have said with reference to the Holy Quran and the hadith which have reached us of the Holy Prophet Muhammad, may the peace and blessings of Allah be upon him, all inform us that there is no person who is not capable of reformation. It is impossible that any one person cannot reform. Each and every person can be reformed. every single person can become one who obtains the general mercy of God, which extends to all. But this is with the condition that in his heart and also practically, he strives to bring about pious changes within himself. Recently, an article was written by a woman in a religious newspaper in Denmark. She wrote regarding the Holy Quran that repeatedly punishment and wrath are mentioned. The word love has not been mentioned anywhere or only in a handful of instances. She went on to say that to assert that faith in God is out of one's own volition and out of love of the divine is something which can never be true, at least not in the case of Muslims. So some of these verses she presented out of context or wrongly to try to establish that the God of Islam is quick in giving wrath and seizing in punishment. Nonetheless, the Jamaat there is replying to this. In any case, I have provided these few instances. Where the believers are given a message of hope, there also to such columnists and also enemies of Islam, who attribute falsehood towards the religion of Islam, and who hold malice and spite against the Holy Quran and Islam, are rebutted. Allah is the Malik, He is the Master, He forgives. This is an attribute which encompasses all others. God forgives and also extends His mercy. It is God's mercy that despite the countless injustices and wrongdoings of man, He does not give them immediate punishment. Indeed, it may be the case that as a result of transgression and sins and wrongdoing, and then remaining obstinate on that, God says that such a person will be punished. One who constantly transgresses and commits sins and does not desist will be chastised. This is a law of nature, and in fact, this is also the law in the world. Yet Allah is so merciful that a time will come when ultimately hell will also be emptied. So thus this is the vastness and limitlessness of the mercy of God. In these verses, Allah the Almighty, after depicting His mercy and forgiveness, says that if even then you do not avail of My mercy and forgiveness, then you will also be punished for your sins and wrongdoing. But it is My mercy and it is My forgiveness which constantly draws your attention from avoiding this. Secure and protect yourselves before punishment overtakes you. As a result of exceeding in wrongdoing, you will be seized by My punishment, so try to save yourselves from this. Now, what can be said about those who still raise allegations despite hearing this, then that they are merely filled with spite, maliciousness, and rancor? In the laws of the countries that are made, they desire to give punishments for wrongdoings. However, to those who break the laws of God, those who exceed in transgression and injustices, they say, why does God say that He will punish and chastise? The God of Islam is most forgiving. This is elucidated through this narration. Hazrat Abu Sayyid, may Allah be pleased with him, narrates that the noble Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said that there was a person from the children of Israel who had killed 99 people. These examples are being cited to depict how the mercy of God is perpetual. So he said that he had killed 99 people, and then he asked about repentance. He approached a monk and inquired whether repentance was still possible. The monk responded that no, there is no route left. So that man even killed this monk. So he went on inquiring whether his repentance could be accepted. One person said, "Go to such and such town." En route to that town, he died. When he fell down dead, he turned his chest towards that town. The angels of mercy and the angels of punishment and started arguing amongst one another. To that town where that person was traveling to, God commanded it to draw near, and to that town from which he had traveled from, God commanded it to be far removed. He then enjoined the angels to measure the distance between the townships. So the town in his direction towards he was traveling to have his sins forgiven was one span away from him. Subsequently, Allah the Almighty forgave him because of this. So this is the God of Islam, who rather than punishment, prefers to forgive. His mercy is all-encompassing. There is another hadith. Hadrat Abu Zar, may Allah be pleased with him, narrates from the Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He said regarding his Lord, the Glorious, the Sublime, the Exalted, that he says, "O children of Adam, you do not pray from me, yet you have hopes and expectations of me. So with this condition that you do not associate partners with me, I will forgive you of your sins, even if your sins amount to the entire earth, for I will meet you with my mercy, which immerses and fills the entire earth. If you have committed errors and wrongdoings, the size of the heavens, seek forgiveness of me, and I will grant you it. And I will not look down upon you even an iota." This is God the Almighty, who is the God of Islam and who forgives. There are countless favors of God the Almighty upon us. Amongst them, one is that every year in Ramadan, he even further opens the doors of his forgiveness. Regarding the forgiveness and mercy of God in Ramadan, there is a narration. Nazr bin Shaban relates that I said to Abu Salma Abdul Rahman, "Inform me of any such thing that you heard from your father, which he heard directly from the Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam with regards to the month of Ramadan." Abu Salma bin Abdul Rahman responded, "Indeed, my father said to me that the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam said that God the Holy, the High, has made the fasting in Ramadan obligatory upon you, and I have established this and the prayer as obligatory. So he who in a state of belief with the intention of obtaining blessings fasts, is delivered from sin as if his mother has newly given birth to him. He becomes like a newborn child. So therefore, we are not the least concerned how ignorant people view the God in Islam. For we are fully aware that our Lord loves us even more than our parents and forgives us. He is the God who runs towards us so that he can forgive his servants of their sins." There is another hadith in regards to Ramadan. The blessings of Ramadan have been mentioned therein. Salman, may Allah be pleased with him, narrates that the Messenger of Allah, may the peace and blessings of Allah be upon him, addressed us on the last day of Shaban. He said, O people, a great and most blessed month is about to dawn upon you. In that month there is a night which is better than 1,000 months. Allah has made it obligatory to fast in this month, and has made it optional to pray during the night in it. هو شهر أوله رحمة وأوسطه مغفرة وآخره إتق من النار. This is the month in which the first 10 days are of mercy, the middle 10 days are the means of forgiveness, and the last 10 days are to give deliverance from hell. He who satiates, one who fasts, will be given to drink from God's lake of abundance, that he will never go thirsty before entering paradise. That is to say that the forgiveness is in such a manner that his past sins are forgiven, and he also gains the strength to desist from future sins. This is when fasting is observed, doing justice to Ramadan, and voluntary prayers are made, and worship to God is undertaken. So at every step, God is providing such provisions, which can enable us to enter into paradise. We are passing through Ramadan nowadays. The second 10 days are coming to an end, and the third set of 10 days is about to commence tomorrow or the day after. The 10 days we are about to enter is especially blessed, because as is mentioned in the hadith, that there is such a night in them, which is the Laylatul Qadr, the night of decree, which regarding the acceptance of prayers and also drawing near to God, are a great means of showing the manifestation of God's love and might. So therefore, in these 10 days, we will have to make special efforts and arrangements for our prayers and supplications. Whatever you attain in it, you should especially make it a part and parcel of your lives. In order to constantly benefit from God's forgiveness and mercy, you should especially remain vigilant upon your condition and state during this month. You should do justice to Ramadan and especially give the due to the last 10 days. In order to remove your vices and to protect yourself from future bad deeds, in order to gain permanent deliverance from hell and punishment, you need to struggle. Effort needs to be made for every task. It can never be the case that you can carry out any work without effort. This is a general principle. It is expected of a true mu'min, a true believer, that to the glad tidings given from God, the messages given from God, the messages of hope given by the Holy Prophet, all of these things should not be given a cursory glance. Rather, when you hear about them, you should develop a yearning and zeal to become a part of them. This yearning and passion will only avail you when you take practical steps to acquire them. Only those practical steps bear fruit and lead you towards success, which are in accordance with those principles and which are taken in accordance with those ways, which have been formed in order to obtain this objective. So therefore, indeed, Allah the Almighty's mercy is all-encompassing, and without any doubt, the reward for good deeds in Ramadan is multiplied manifold. Undoubtedly, Ramadan is a means for obtaining forgiveness and mercy and saving yourself from hell. However, only he will obtain permanent benefit from these things who makes a dedicated and constant effort towards it. So fortunate are those amongst us, or fortunate will be those from us, who make this Ramadan a means of acquiring mercy and forgiveness, and gaining deliverance from hell and punishment. That we remove our weaknesses and shortcomings. That we permanently and constantly desist from vices. That this Ramadan becomes that landmark for us, which enables us to always resist bad things and constantly takes us towards virtues. We should develop such repulsion towards evil and bad deeds, which never allows us to revert to them again. We should remain constantly focused to true repentance. Our repentance should constantly be a means of gaining nearness to God. How can these things be achieved? And how can true repentance be acquired, which permanently keeps us away from vices? The promised Messiah on whom be peace says in this regard, that repentance for gaining good morals is actually something very useful, which burns away sins. If you want to develop the best character and highest morals and gain nearness to God, then it is repentance alone which can benefit you in this sense. A person progresses through this. It will assist you in this purpose. The promised Messiah continues, this also perfects man. He who desires to reform his morals, it is necessary for him that with a sincere heart and firm resolve, he repents. It should be borne in mind that there are three conditions for repentance. Repentance is not achieved merely by repentance. Without fulfillment of these three conditions, which are called Tawbah al-Nusuh, true repentance is not achieved. What are these conditions? The promised Messiah says, the first condition, which in Arabic is called Iqlaa, it is to rid oneself of those wicked thoughts and fancies which arouse evil propensities. In realities, ideas and thoughts have great influence, because every action is preceded by an idea. Thus, the prime condition for repentance is that evil thoughts and fancies should be discarded. For instance, if a person has an illicit relationship with a woman and desires to repent, it is necessary that he should conceive of her as ugly and should call to mind all her low qualities. As I have just said, thoughts and fancies exercise a powerful influence. I have read that some Sufis carried their fancies to such a length that they saw a person in the form of an ape or pig. In short, everything takes on the color and reflection of how you imagine it to be. Thus, the first condition of repentance is that all thoughts which give rise to evil pleasures should be discarded altogether. So this is the first condition. The second condition is remorse. Everyone's conscience admonishes him and warns him over every evil. But an unfortunate person leaves his conscience suspended. So a sinner should express remorse over his sin and evil action, and should reflect that the pleasure to be deprived from them is temporary. He should also consider that every time there is a decline in that pleasure, and that in the end, in old age, when his faculties are weakened and diminish, he will perforce have to give up all these pleasures. Then why indulge in that which in the end has to be given up anyhow? Most fortunate is the person who turns in repentance and becomes determined to discard all corrupt thoughts and vile fancies. When he gets rid of this impurity, he should be remorseful. The third condition is a firm resolve that he will not revert to those vices. If he adheres to this resolve, God will bestow upon him the strength for true repentance, and he will be rid altogether of his vices, which will be replaced by good morals and praiseworthy actions. This is a moral victory. It is for God Almighty to bestow the power and strength for it, for He is the master of all power and all strength. As He has said, أَنَّ الْقُوَّةَ لِلَّهِ جَمِيعًا all power belongs to Allah. Man has been made structurally weak. خُلِقَ الْإِنسَانَ ضَعِيفًا. This is the reality. So in order to gain strength and power from God, one should perfect all the aforementioned faculties and should rid himself of slackness and negligence, and he should dedicatedly pray to God. God will reform his morals. So therefore, this is a statement of the promised Messiah on whom be peace. Such people should always remember this, who say that we have prayed to be saved from such and such vice, but that vice has not been eliminated, and God has not answered our prayers. Some parents are concerned for their children who have developed some bad habits. They assert that they have made efforts, that they have prayed, yet their prayers have not been heard. This is completely wrong. So I shall explain this in a simple manner once again, that for the acceptance of prayers, there are certain requirements and conditions which are necessary to fulfill. To just pray for a few days and then profess that God has not accepted your prayers is to try and place the burden of your own inaptitude and incompetence upon God. Nonetheless, as I have said, I have just presented this extract of the promised Messiah on whom be peace, of how one can desist from vice, and how repentance can be achieved. From this, I want to inform that as the promised Messiah on whom be peace has said, to undertake repentance and to desist from vices, there are some necessary requirements. Actions and efforts are necessary. There are some ways that you would have to implement. If you do so, only then will you achieve the desired results. To desist from vices, your prayers will only then be accepted when you also take some practical measures. If you do not take any practical steps and merely pray in a cursory manner and assert that God has not accepted your prayer, and then to think that perhaps God wills for me to remain a sinner, is a completely wrong notion. If you want to reform your bad actions and improve your morals, then the promised Messiah on whom be peace has explained that there are three conditions which man must first make an effort to achieve. When he then prays, the prayers assist him. The evils are then removed. As I said in the reference for true repentance, the promised Messiah on whom be peace said that the first matter is that one should free his mind from evil and illicit thoughts. First, one conjures up the perception of the delight and enjoyment of a bad deed, and then he acts upon it. If one did not even have the idea or fancy in his mind and think of how it will give him delight, and instead abhor it, he will never commit that vice. When someone conjures up the thought and fancy of the delight and enjoyment in any vice, he becomes inclined towards it. So the first practical step that man needs to take to desist from bad deeds is that he has to cleanse his mind of bad fancies and also temporary delights. The promised Messiah on whom be peace cites the example of one who has an illicit relationship with a woman. So instead of developing a good impression in one's mind of the woman, he should instead think of her as ugly. Instead of looking at all her aspects of beauties and her good qualities, one should try and produce the worst possible image of her in his thoughts. Her bad qualities should be borne in mind by him. One should form an extremely repulsive and abhorrent perception. Only then will you be able to refrain from committing that desist. The second condition that he has outlined is that you should summon and arouse your pious intentions, and you should ponder on the vices that you are becoming embroiled in. You should develop remorse and shame within your heart. If this condition prevails, only then will you be able to save yourself from vices. The third aspect is that you should have a firm resolve that you will never revert to that vice. When you strive at all times to remain firm in this resolve, then Allah the Almighty enables you to conduct true repentance. He then also listens to real prayers to be saved from the evil. These are the practical steps that need to be undertaken before the prayers are accepted. It cannot be the case that from morning to night and night to morning, you remain embroiled in bad deeds, and then at any one time, you supplicate to God to be saved from that vice. Such an act would itself show that you are not praying with seriousness. That pious nature which is the conscious, which is latent within, that any one time thrusts your conscience to ask, what state are you embroiled in these vices? If through this temporary realization, it leads to you giving short-term heed towards prayer, yet when you see the temptation of that bad deed in front of you, it eliminates that realization and it overwhelms any sense of repentance. Such a condition will never prevent you from perpetrating vices, nor will it enable you to do justice to your prayers. Indeed, this would actually be a mockery of prayer and is an attempt to restrict God. God is not limited or restricted by any person. So such people should remember that if you want to avail of the forgiveness of God and receive His rewards and bounties and see your prayers being accepted, then you also need to give heed towards your condition and state. As I said, Allah is so kind and favorable to His servants that He is ever ready to cloak His servants in His mercy. Does this not require of us that we also act upon God's commands and receive His forgiveness? May we attain that mercy which is received by true believers and His dear ones. May we be saved from those things which, despite His all-encompassing mercy, make us liable for wrath. May our repentance be true repentance, and may we constantly be in submission to Him. The promised Messiah on whom we peace says, cleanse and purify your actions. Always remember God and be not negligent. Just like a running prey, when it becomes a little lazy, he gets caught himself. In the same way, he who is negligent of the worship of God is entrapped by Satan. Always keep your repentance alive. Never let it die. Because only that limb or part of the body which is used will be beneficial. If a limb or body part is not used, it becomes permanently inactive. Similarly, keep your repentance alive and active so it does not become useless. If you do not carry out true repentance, it is like the seed which is tried to be planted in a stone. And if it is true repentance, it will be like the seed which is planted in extremely suitable and fertile ground, and it brings forth the fruit at the appointed time. There are great difficulties in carrying out this repentance, because a person always has in mind the temptations and delights of this world. He says, our weapon of triumph is istighfar, toba, repentance, knowledge of religious matters, keeping in view the greatness of God, and to offer the five daily prayers. The formal prayer is the key for the acceptance of supplications. When you pray, you should not be negligent, but you supplicate properly. Avoid every vice, whether it relates to the rights of God or the rights of mankind. May Allah the Almighty enable us to be counted amongst those who do true repentance. May we continuously receive the blessings and bounties of God. May Allah the Almighty enable us to attain all those blessings and graces which are connected to Ramadan. At this time, after the Friday prayers, I will lead three funeral prayers in absentia. The first funeral is of respected Muhammad Imtiaz Ahmed, son of Mushtaq Ahmed Tahir, who lived in Nawabshah. On 14th July, he was martyred. Inna lillahi wa inna ilayhi raji'un. He was approximately 39 years old. At 4:30 in the evening, two unknown people on motorbikes came to his cycle, fired at him, and martyred him. Inna lillahi wa inna ilayhi raji'un. According to the reports, Imtiaz Ahmed Sahib was in the trunk bazaar in Nawabshah, standing outside his shop, when two unknown assailants on motorbikes fired at him and fled. The shooting caused three bullets to hit him, two on his head on one side and one crossed his head from the ear. The third bullet hit his hand. In any case, he was martyred on the spot. Inna lillahi wa inna ilayhi raji'un. As a result of religious bigotry in Nawabshah, this is the ninth martyrdom. These martyrdoms have more or less happened in the last few years. A few days before this incident, the martyred was told by a shopkeeper that there are some opponents who are scheming against you. However much one takes care, you eventually have to leave the house and opponents then gain an opportunity. In the family of the martyred, Ahmadiyya started in 1935 through his grandfather Sayyid Muhammadin Sahib. He did the bayat through Ne'matullah Khan Sahib of Wazirabad. In 1947, he moved from Amritsar, India to Nawabshah, Pakistan. He was born in 1975. He then completed his FSC and later engaged with his father in business. He did a lot of services for the Jamaat. At the time of his martyrdom, he was the sadr of the Jamaat and his halqa. He was Secretary Tariq-e-Jadid and a Secretary Islah-e-Shad for the city. He was also Qaid Khudamul Ahmadiyya, an auxiliary organization of Nawabshah. He was Nazim Islah-e-Shad of the district and also the Ilaka. He was Nazim Tariq-e-Jadid of the district. In the past, he was Secretary Waqf-e-Jadid and also Secretary Ziafat and Secretary Dawat-e-Allah. He was ever ready to serve the Jamaat. He excellently fulfilled all tasks given to him. He never declined from carrying out any responsibility. He was greatly hospitable. He would greatly take care of the central guests, and he possessed a simple disposition. He had great love and devotion with Khilafat. He had extraordinary passion of obedience. He performed his five daily prayers and also the Tahajjud. He always spoke in a soft and gentle disposition. He had the quality of always forgiving others. Last year, he also attended the Qadian Jalsa. On the day of his martyrdom, with reference to Ramadan, he personally prepared ration packets for the people. He distributed this in seven homes. When he returned, two unknown assailants, wicked people, attacked him and martyred him. With the grace of the Almighty Allah, he is a Musi. He was the nephew of the late Sayyid Muhammad Sahib Shaheed, the martyr, who is a former Amir of the district of Nawabshah. His father, Mushtaq Ahmed Sahib, is also alive. He also leaves behind his wife, Nabila Imtiaz Sahiba, three sons, Jazib, who is 10, Abdul Basit, who is 9, and Muhammad Abdullah Umar, who is 7. The second funeral is our respected Nasir Ahmad Amjib Sahib, Waqf-e Zindagi, life devotee, and who was a teacher in Jamia Ahmadiyya Rabwa. He did his metric exams in 1981, then he dedicated his entire life as Waqf. He went to Jamia for studies. He did a BA in Jamia. Then he graduated and did an MA. Then he did a Russian course arranged by the Jamaat. In 1988, after achieving his Shahid degree, he entered the field and stayed in various Jamaats. In 1990, he was summoned to Rabwa to specialize in different religions. During his thesis, he began to teach in Jamia as a teacher. And formally, on 12th July 1999, he became a full-time teacher, appointed to teach different religions. Until the end, he continued to perform this excellent responsibility. Since graduating from Jamia, his span of service spreads over 26 years. With the grace of the Almighty Allah, in terms of the knowledge of different religions, despite the fact that he was amongst the young missionaries and scholars, he was still an authority. He had in-depth knowledge. He also served in different departments. He was amongst those early representatives of the Qaza who were appointed by Hazrat Khalifa Masih IV, where he remained until the end. He was also a member of the research cell Majlis Iftar. He served in various capacities in Qudamul Ahmadiyya. Another quality he possessed, as informed by the people in home, that he never tolerated anyone speaking against the Nizami Jamaat. Even if he heard his child speaking against any officeholder, he would admonish them. If anyone spoke against any Jamaat decision or Jamaat personality, he would explain to them. He had the honor of attending the Jalsa Salana, UK, and in 2010, perhaps he delivered a speech here at the Jalsa. He also wrote to me this time that I have applied. Pray that I receive my visa. But it was rejected and then he reapplied. He had an extraordinary relationship and connection with Khilafat of love. He was amongst the true helpers in this sense. He had great enthusiasm for preaching, who traveled to every majlis. He had a lot of experience in the field of preaching also. He would even convince very highly educated people through arguments. His daughter writes that he had extreme dedicated love for the Promised Messiah alayhi salam. He gave a lot of emphasis on reading the books of the Promised Messiah on whom be peace. He was writing a lexicon of the book of the Promised Messiah alayhi salam, and he was worried for this treasure to reach the people. He was writing a dictionary of difficult words so people could avail of the writings of the Promised Messiah alayhi salam. He had only just commenced this work. Mubashir Ayaz Sahib has also written that he was a very good speaker in Rahi Oda and also many other MTA programs he participated, and he would give very convincing answers. May Allah the Almighty give him forgiveness and elevate his status and rank. May Allah the Almighty grant such scholars who also practice what they preach to be given to the Jamaat. The third funeral is a respected Sahibzada Mirza Anwar Ahmad Sahib, who was the son of Hazrat Muslih Maud, may Allah be pleased with him, and also the son of Hazrat Nasir. He passed away last Monday. Inna lillahi wa inna ilayhi raji'un. Surely to Allah we belong and to Him we shall return. He passed his matriculation in 1944 and then upon the desire of Hazrat Muslih Maud, he enrolled at the Agricultural College. He was entrusted with the responsibility by Hazrat Muslih Maud of the administration of the old and very early Darul Ziyafat. The early construction of the renovated Dar al-Ziyafah also happened in his period. Until 82-83, he continued to serve of the Afsar Langar Khana. He also was unable to serve as Nazim Amuriyama. Then Hazrat Khalifa Siyasani also entrusted him with looking over his land. He was married to Sahibzada Sabiha Begum Sahiba, son of Mirza Rashid Ahmed Sahib, son of Mirza Sultan Ahmed Sahib. He has three sons and one daughter. Amongst the weddings of the grandchildren of Hazrat Amma Jan, his wedding was the last which Hazrat Amma Jan participated in. Dr. Nuri Sahib writes that for the last 3 decades, I've been unable to serve him. He was an extremely sincere person who was very hospitable and loving. Hospitality was a prominent quality of his. Another prominent quality he possessed is that he had a very good sense of humor. He would joke with people in the gatherings. And even in gloomy meetings, due to his humor, he would produce life. Dr. Nuri Sahib writes, he would often come to help those patients who were poor or unable to afford it themselves. He was the brother of our mother. They had a special relationship as is of the brother, but he would frequently visit our house. He maintained this relationship, and here after Khilafat, he also had a great relationship with me. He would often phone and mention this special connection. May Allah the Almighty also extend His mercy and forgiveness to him and elevate his status. May Allah the Almighty also enable his children and progeny to continue this relationship of loyalty with Khilafat. His wife is also quite ill. May Allah the Almighty also grant her mercy. As I said, after the Friday prayer, I will lead these funeral prayers.
Alhamdulillah, nahmaduhu wa nasta'inuhu wa nastaghfiruhu wa nu'minu bihi wa natawakkalu alayhi wa na'uzu billahi min shururi anfusina wa min sayyi'ati a'malina من يهد الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له ونشهد ان لا اله الا الله ونشهد ان محمدا عبده ورسوله عباد الله رحمكم الله إن الله يأمر بالعدل واللسان وإيتاء ذي القربى وينهى عن الفحشاء والمنكر والبغي يعظكم لعلكم تذكرون اذكروا الله يذكركم وَدُوهُ يَسْتَجِبْ لَكُمْ وَلَذِكْرُ اللَّهِ أَكْبَرُ